Welcome to Tarot Card Meanings with Benabelle. Closed captioning is provided for all videos in this lecture series. In this video installment, we will be covering the sixes. The sixes are where the flux of the previous fives are restored to balance, and there's a beauty to the symmetry. Six is the Pythagorean number of the soul, and this is a Jungian psychological theory of integration, where individual and collective consciousness merge. Here are the lords of victory, pleasure, science, and success. In our solar system, Tiferet corresponds with the Sun, and in the Christian Trinity of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, sixes designate the hypostases of the Sun. I'm quoting that from Aleister Crowley in the Book of Thoth. The four guardian spirits of the realm of sixes in the Spirit Keeper's Tarot are the Champion, the Memory Keeper, the Ferryman, and the Giver. Now let's run a comparative analysis on how these sixes are imagined in the Tarot de Marseille, in which we'll be referencing Atea, Papus, and McGregor Mathers, then the Tarot deck by Arthur Edward Waite, illustrated by Pamela Coleman-Smith, referencing the Pictorial Key and my textbook, Holistic Tarot, and the Thoth Tarot by Aleister Crowley, illustrated by Lady Frieda Harris, consulting the Book of Thoth and relevant Thelemic texts by Crowley. The fourth system we'll be studying is my deck, the Spirit Keeper's Tarot. The sixes in the tarot pips correspond with the Sephira Tiferet, which is the only Sephirot connected to all the other Sephirot except Malkut. In the order of the universe, this hub is a center of balance and symmetry. To review what we've learned so far, right now we are below the abyss and concluding the second triad above the veil. However, let's talk about the controversy of the veil. Some place the veil above Yesod, others below Yesod, others right through. Still others place it below the second triad of Hexad, Givra, and Tiferet, which is what I'm illustrating here on screen. The veil is a curtain or threshold that separates between ordinary consciousness and deeper spiritual consciousness. So assuming we observe the tradition that places the veil just below Tiferet, this video will conclude exploration of the second triad behind the veil. Also, in Aleister Crowley's Book of Thoth, he directs our attention to the direct line of communication between Tiferet and Ketor. The very spiritual DNA of the Ruach is endowed to us through Tiferet. Ruach, the Hebrew word for breath, spirit, or wind. It's the Greek word pneuma. This is the gift of creative power from the divine to us. As Crowley puts it, the Son is an interpretation of the Father in terms of the mind. Crowley, Book of Thoth. In Eastern cosmology, this is Qi. Another synchronicity of note, the eight elements of Chinese metaphysics, is expressed by the Bagua, and here you see the eight paths from Tiferet. A quick review. The fours from the pips, or numbered cards in the minor arcana, signified the first point of awareness of divinity. Themes explored here are order and structure of the divine plan. Here we are going to receive revelations for what it means to live a good life. The fives denote a state of flux. These are the marks of suffering as a sacrament. Here there are influential energies in conflict. When you see a five, think about which form of conflict it's designating to you, man versus man versus environment, or man versus himself. The fives then develop into the sixes, and on screen, please focus on the six of wands in the top left corner. This is optimism and confidence rewarded. The six of cups, focusing now on the top right corner, is an emotional catharsis. The Six of Swords, bottom left, is the mind motivating the body on a passage from flux to balance. A rational cohesion takes place here. And finally, the Six of Pentacles, coins or discs, bottom right. A benefit or gain materializes right before you. Gains and profit to come. Let's start by focusing on the Terre de Marseille Six of Bâtons. Recall the sequence of ornamentation patterns from the two, then three, four, up to this point, the six. One thing to start thinking about for yourself as a Marseille reader is how do you interpret the baton pips when they feature flowers, compared to how you interpret the baton pips when they do not feature flowers. If you're asking me, it seems like when there's a flower, we're going to get a much more proactively positive indication. When the Six of Batons shows up, the matter you are querying about will turn out for the best. The outcome will be for the best. However, and there is a big but here, if you're reading with reversals, or the Six of Batons is flanked on all sides with negative meaning cards, then its ill-dignified omen comes through. Ill-dignified, the Six of Batons is a warning that someone in your inner circle is being unfaithful or disloyal to you, breaching your trust, doing things behind your back, and pulling the wool over your eyes. You're being misled to believe everything is okay when it's anything but. It can also mean there is undeserved success. Someone, maybe you, who knows, depends on the layout of cards, is getting away with doing something bad, a bad actor that goes unnoticed. Common keywords associated with an ill-dignified Six of Batons are infidelity, treachery, loyalty, and perfidy. In the Rider-Waite-Smith Six of Wands, the deck system most tarot readers are familiar with, we see a laureled horseman, and not only that, but this laureled horseman bears a staff adorned with another laurel crown. Waite directs us to these omens because they're important. This is the mark of a leader, a champion, someone who has won a martial victory, meaning there was a battle, a conflict of some kind, and then you won that battle. In Greek mythology, the laurel wreath on the head is associated with Apollo, god of light, prophecy, knowledge, healing, athletics. So the mystical subtext when the Six of Wands shows up is you have the blessing of Apollo. But when the card appears in reverse, Waite tells us, brace yourself for a Trojan horse in the midst. Echoing what we learned about the ill-dignified Six of Batons in the Marseille, this is a warning that a person or an energy, a force at large, is invisibly or in a concealed way undermining your endeavors. Be careful that you're not inadvertently opening your gates to let in the enemy. There is treachery at large. In the Thoth Six of Wands, we continue to see similar indications. Crowley tells us that the Six of Wands is the element of fire at its best. Recall the Five of Wands from our previous video lecture. This was an outburst of sudden, violent fire energy that caused strife. All recall the symbol of the winged sun up top from Zoroastrian mythos. In the Six of Wands, the winged sun multiplies from one to two. When the Six of Wands shows up, you've overcome past hardships and victory is yours. This is crossing the threshold of success. Reversed or ill-dignified, not all of the fire at its best energies goes away. So victory is still a strong possibility, but now it's not exactly a guarantee. There are still energies in flux that could sway the outcome. If in a past position in your tarot spread, then you missed out on an opportunity that was right at your front doorstep, dropped directly onto your lap and line of vision. But for whatever reason, you missed it. You overlooked your window of opportunity and therefore it passed you by. The Six of Wands reversed is the key of missed opportunity. In my deck, the SKT, the Six of Scepters is the spirit of the champion. Remember in the Five of Scepters, the contender, we had a struggle, a battle going on. The champion is the victor of that struggle and is now sitting on the throne. In the Major Arcana Key 6, the Lovers card, Malkuth is not visible in the Gra formation of the Tree of Life. Ah, I've drawn it as a fruit on the tree of knowledge, which appears as a symbol, an omen on the base of the throne in the Six of Scepters. Key 1, the Magus or Magician card, corresponds with Mercury, which is the ruling planet for the zodiac sign Gemini. And I've mentioned the bond between Key 6, the Lovers, and the Six of Scepters, the Champion. Tying it all together, you'll see the Phoenician alphabet letter for Bet, most prominently in the background of the Champion card, which is the corresponding letter in the Magus. Key 6, the lovers, is relative to key 15, the demon or devil card numerologically, because for 15, 1 plus 5 is 6. The shadow side of the Six of Scepters, the champion, is key 15, the demon. This is an unseen, occult driving impulse propelling the champion and will come out even more prominently if and when the Six of Scepters appears in reverse or ill-dignified. Returning our attention to the Deacon rulership for the Six of Scepters, Jupiter in Leo, the energies of Leo rule this card as it did in the Five of Scepters when our champion was still just a contender. Later in this video series, we'll talk about how the demon is connected to the Force. Here's that represented by the North and South lunar nodes. All three majors on screen, by the way, key 1, key 8, and key 15, feature the double coiled serpent. Here's a question I get asked a lot. So what? All this, the symbol is connected to that, which represents this, which is an omen for that, which according to history and mythology equates to this. Like, who actually uses any of that in a tarot reading? Good point. And true, you probably won't mention any of the esoteric implications during an actual tarot reading. But learning all of this when you're not in divination mode, but in study mode, will deepen your wisdom, broaden the capabilities of your insights, exercise every psychic muscle, and get you dialed in to the collective unconscious. That way, when you are in the middle of a practical tarot reading, you are connected on a powerful psychic level to the many spirits, many pulses of the collective and space-time that you are just automatically going to give more accurate, more powerful, more spiritual readings. Every minutia of this Learn the Tarot educational series is presented in such a way that I hope you're learning even when you don't realize you're learning. I'm hoping osmosis is a real thing, and just by watching these videos, you are absorbing and integrating esoteric knowledge that will better inform your practical knowledge. That's why you study tarot symbolism. Okay, back to the tarot sixes. So what I showed earlier about the Six of Scepters was to open up the hood of the car and show you how all the gears were arranged, which probably won't make a whole lot of sense to anyone who isn't a mechanic. Now, let's just talk about card meaning extrapolated from the arrangements of gears. On its face, this is a simple card to interpret. Triumph, victory, achievement. Adorning the gates of the throne room are the seven double letters in the Sefer Yetzirah, Beth, Gimel, Daleth, Kaf, Peh, Resh, and Dao, which, when in creative mode, signify wisdom, wealth, seed, life, dominance, peace, and grace. These are fruits you enjoy when you are the champion and you use your power creatively. In destructive mode, when malefic, the sacred seven planetary rulers bring folly, poverty, desolation, death, subjugation, war, and ugliness, the shadow side of harvesting the fruit. Notice the self-inflicted wound from the scepter with the wreath. This was important to me to convey because I don't want anyone to pursue championship or leadership blind to its consequences. No champion in the world achieves that status without enduring a great deal of pain. For there to be victory, there must be self-sacrifice. When the champion uses the attained power and prestige in a way that's productive, the dignified blessings of the double letters will bear fruit: wisdom, wealth, dominance, peace, grace, and so on. When the champion uses the attained power and prestige in a way that's destructive, the ill-dignified penances will bear fruit: folly, poverty, subjugation or downfall, ugliness, desolation, and so on. The Six of Cups represents an emotional catharsis. Catharsis is a purge or total release of tensions. It's that satisfying exhale after you've been holding your breath for a little too long. I'll repeat this later, but want to underscore that the Six of Cups, at least according to Aleister Crowley, is one of the best cards in the tarot deck. The Six of Cups in the Tarot de Marseille designates the past. This is past memory, past experiences, past lives, all that which has gone by or elapsed in time. Surrounding cards will reveal the nature and themes of those past memories. Ataya instructs that the positioning of this card in a reading marks the boundary between past and future. Every card drawn that came before the Six of Cups designates the past, and every card drawn that comes after the Six of Cups designates the future. Mathers interprets the positioning of the Six of Cups as prophetic of whether the future can be changed. In the past position, yes. In a present or future position, no, because the point of no return has passed. What's to come will be the necessary effects of the causes you put into motion. But who cares, because it's all positive. This card is a bearer of good tidings. Mutable or immutable, it foretells happiness. Reversed, the Six of Cups designates the future. Because the Six of Cups in general is a powerful, positive card in the tarot deck architecture, the future being foretold here is profoundly prophetic, and you should be feeling an intensity of spirit energy enlivened all around you. Reversed, the Six of Cups can also be a warning that the querent is remembering things wrong. There's a concern with faulty or unreliable memory. Alternatively, the reversed Six of Cups can mean that nothing is set in stone and the future is completely unpredictable at this time. In the Rider-Waite-Smith Tarot, the Six of Cups features two children in an old garden, their cups filled with flowers. That's the description we get from the pictorial key. Echoing Ataya and Mathers, Waite tells us that the Six of Cups is the card of the past and of memories and fond, joyous ones at that. The figure, an adult with a walking stick back turned to us, is a significant indicator when this card comes up in readings. I look to the cards that precede it, whether it's by sequence, meaning the card in time that you, the tarot reader, pulled immediately before the Six of Cups, or it's by layout on the table, the card physically positioned adjacent to this figure. I'll read that card as hidden memory or forgotten memory, overlooked memory, something deeply buried inside the querent that is the very key to solving that querent's present or future problem. Maybe it's something vaulted inside that spirit wants the querent to unlock and remember. Waite also tells us that the Six of Cups has another meaning, which you will intuit based on your spread of cards. It can mean something new is coming as a direct result of past acts. The direct effect caused by the past means you're headed on a direct path toward a new relationship, new knowledge, or a change of environment, a relocation, change into something new. Reversed, the Six of Cups is the opposite of the card upright. It means the future. What happened in the past is about to happen again, a recurrence of the same thing. This is a recycling of events, a repeat of what came before. Crowley tells us that the Six of Cups is the element of water at its best. This is a sign of fertility and incredible power for production and reproduction. It's being abundantly productive with your imagination, your creativity, producing progeny. This is one of the best cards in the pack, writes Crowley. The Lord of Pleasure denotes an absence of pain. This is the pleasure principle in Freudian psychoanalysis. In Hellenistic philosophy, pleasure is the universal drive and ultimate objective to have no turmoil or conflict in the mind, body, or spirit, because the Suit of Cups is the suit of sensations. This is also the card of sensuous pleasure. Reversed, the Six of Cups is pleasure in excess. This is Epicurean pleasure that becomes extreme hedonism. There is a certain connotation of exploit here. Let's also examine the Lord of Pleasure, bifurcated per Epicurean ethics, divided into the two categories of mental or spiritual pleasure, the pleasures of the mind, and also sensual, tactile pleasures. These are the pleasing sensations to the physical body. Upright, The Lord of Pleasure denotes pleasures of the mind. This is joy, pleasant memories, and per Epicurean philosophy, these pleasures endure past, present, and future. Reversed, we see the dominance of the pleasures of the body. These are temporary, fleeting joys. The happiness, fertility, and abundance prognosticated by the card may be short-lived. In the Spirit Keeper's Tarot, the Six of Chalices is the residence for the Memory Keeper. Recall the influence of the Theosophic Sixes in the Majors over the Sixes in the Minors. The Dragon and Phoenix, signifying both the inner and outer alchemical duality, is in their nascent stages here in the Six of Chalices, just hatched. Once again, notice the bifurcated model of Epicurean pleasure. Pleasures of the mind or spirit and pleasures of the body and sensations. Both drive the indications from the Six of Chalices, producing six particular byproducts of pleasure, signified by the six daffodils. They are unrequited love, good fortune, self-love, honor, hope, and joy or cheer. When the Memory Keeper appears in your reading, take note of your first impression. Which of these six chalices are you most immediately drawn to? For example, in the moment, I am most drawn to the center left one. What it symbolizes will reveal to you what the Memory Keeper is gifting to you. That left center would be good fortune. One of the best cards in the pack, said Crowley. Ah, yes, that's because the Memory Keeper is an entry point for access to the Akashic Records, the compendium of all memory in space-time. It's an indicator that the tarot reading in front of you has been extracted from the Akashic Records. So pay closer attention now, because this reading you just did has taken on a far deeper and more poignant significance than you realize. Now let's talk about what the Memory Keeper reveals when it comes to you reversed. There is an intuitive sense of chaos here, emotional confusion, because multiple and disparate future possibilities are spilling forth at you all at the same time, and we are uncertain which will come to fruition. On screen, study how the SKT Six of Chalices syncretizes the three preceding traditions. Ever tried punching data into some high-tech computing device and you get the output error? So personally, that's how I read the Six of Chalices reversed. When it appears in a past position, it's what we talked about earlier, unreliable or faulty memory. What you remember isn't actually what happened. When it appears in a present position, emotional integration is needed. You have to unearth something buried deep within and confront it. Perhaps past life memory recall or inner child work is the diagnosis. And when the Six of Chalices appears in a future position, everything is still on the table. There is a large window of opportunity for change and transformation. Transformation, by the way, being a key word for Scorpio. The Deacon ruler for the Six of Cups is the Sun in Scorpio. Next, for study, the Six of Swords. This is the mind motivating the body on a passage from flux to balance. A rational cohesion takes place here, its disparate particles uniting, most apparent in the image of the Thoth Six of Swords. This is when everything finally comes together in the mind and it all makes sense. If you think about that exact moment you come to a decision, the Six of Swords is that immediate moment after, right after the decision was made. This is the first initiatory step in the new direction. The Six of Swords in the Marseille pack signifies an envoy, a messenger or agent on behalf of someone of high status who will arrive soon enough bearing important news. Alternatively, it can portend travel. This card is about a journey, voyage or passage that results in physical changes of circumstance. When companion cards in the reading are fire dominant, this could signify a career change or a journey relating to a creative endeavor, a passion project. Water dominant neighbor cards will signify a relationship change, an emotional or spiritual journey. Air dominant, and this could relate to schooling, education of some kind, or a change in social status. And earth dominant cards will modify the Six of Swords to indicate a physical change, such as a geographic relocation or a financial change. Reversed, the Six of Swords, whereby the flower ornament is now blossom side down, portends a surprise, a plot twist in your life path to come. Expect the unexpected, goes the cliche. This card often comes up ill-dignified. To indicate a legal matter or legal action, there might be a formal complaint of a legal nature. Maybe there is a witness to something terrible that has happened, and all of this is in some way will have an impact on the querent or on the situation at hand. The Six of Swords reversed can also indicate a romantic proposition, but one that's probably not going to lead to a long-term commitment. This is in all likelihood a stimulating but fleeting romance. Finally, we are still working with the theme of the envoy or messenger in the Six of Swords, but here, reversed, that news is probably not news you want to hear. In the RWS, Waite tells us that this is the image of a ferryman carrying passengers in his punt, or a small, shallow boat, to the further shore. So they're going the distance in some way. Waite tells us that the course is smooth and the freight is light. This card can portend a journey over water or overseas. Another thing worth noting here is Waite describes this card as a sign or omen of the commissionaire, an envoy. A commissionaire is an attendant, a gatekeeper of some kind. This is someone ushering you from one place to the next, a psychopomp, the archetype of Hermes with his staff, shape-shifting into that ferryman or the omen of an underworld journey to come. With the Suit of Swords designating the mind, we might be looking at a state of change in the consciousness. That change in consciousness can be prompted by a physical change in your life or vice versa. A mental change causes you to pursue a physical change. Either way, this is the card thematic of a journey, both a mental and physical movement from point A to point B. Reversed, the Six of Swords, according to Waite's guidebook for the deck he created, this indicates a declaration or confession. For those who think they know tarot card meanings, check this out. According to Waite, the Six of Swords reversed also means publicity, meaning buzz or something buzzworthy. Something you wanted to keep secret or private gets leaked out into the public. Private affairs become public knowledge. In a love and relationships reading, a reversed Six of Swords can indicate a proposition of love that's rejected or won't be permanently fruitful. Nothing long-term or lasting here. In a career reading, a reversed Six of Swords indicates a sociopolitical barrier that you might not be cognizant of that's blocking your advancement. There's sabotage of a sociopolitical nature hindering progress. In the Thoth, the Six of Swords, Lord of Science, is the element of air at its best. All the conceptual pieces fit together and produce technological and scientific advancement. This is using your intelligence to achieve an important goal. Embedded into the imagery here is the symbol for squaring the circle. This is a metaphor for achieving the impossible. The quadrature of the circle was the great work of ancient geometers, a philosophical inspiration of the Freemasons, and in Freemasonry, hence the G in their emblem for geometer. In the Thoth, the Six of Swords is success after struggle. You've solved the problem, and you've used ingenuity to solve that problem. In the Spirit Keeper's Tarot, I used the alchemical symbol for squaring the circle to mark the ferryman's boat. Reversed, the Thoth Six of Swords portends science and technology used in a way that is more destructive than productive. This is exploitation of intellectualism. It's someone too smart for their own good. It might also indicate the abuse of media or exploitation of knowledge in a way that causes harm. It's the fake news card, in a manner of speaking. Isn't this interesting? The Thoth-ascribed meanings are similar thematically to the Rider-Waite-Smith, but then also not. Crowley here has definitely given his own spin to the core classical theme. The SKT Six of Swords is a merger of all those meanings from the Marseille tradition of reading this as an envoy or of a journey and travel to come, to the ferryman navigating a small boat in the Rider-Waite-Smith, the psychopomp and transference simultaneously of mind and body, plus the symbolism of the fright on board, and finally the message of technological advancement, achieving what had been impossible as encoded in the Crowley Harris Thoth. When I need help navigating from point A to point B, I'll call upon the ferryman as a talisman card. The turbulent waters behind the boat indicate uncertainty, and now, armed with knowledge symbolized by Mercury and the great work, plus the fright of the swords, it will be smoother sailing ahead. Knowledge always empowers. In the Spirit Keeper's Tarot, the cloaked figure is also Ironheart in disguise, and her silver wheel presenting as the emblem of Mercury. So I've pushed the card meaning even further into the depths because here, the Six of Swords is about reincarnation, perhaps even a sense of karmic retribution, and that river is the Aurora Borealis. I distinguish this from the Wheel of Fortune or Wheel of Fortune card, which is about cycles, space, and time being cyclic. Here, we're zooming in on a specific line of if-then, cause and effect, one very particular progression of karmic fate along the rope of time. Reversed, well, gaze at the reversed ferryman. I mean, how does seeing this card make you feel? I feel uneasy because there's a sense of emptying, falling out, draining, collapse, energy of the fallen, thwarted. And look, as uneasy as it may feel, this can actually be a good thing. This is diverting the flow of karma, and that can mean something positive. I read this as science, something man-made, artificial, a science or occult technology used to fundamentally change the course of fate or karma. On to the Six of Coins, Pentacles, or Discs, depending on which deck you're working with. In the Spirit Keeper's Tarot, this is the Six of Orbs. When this card shows up, no matter which of these four deck systems you're using, a benefit or gain materializes, earnings and profit to come. This is sustenance, stability, material and financial security. The world you step upon is fertile. In the Marseille Six of Coins, this is the card of charity and a charitable act that will bring you significantly closer to self-sufficiency, materialist harmony, meaning financial harmony. This is a card that indicates economic balance. If we're using stock market terms, this is a bull market. Mathers also calls this card the card of gratification of security through amassing a fortune or significant gain. When this card comes up, you're going to feel gratification. Something will happen that brings you a sense of immediate happiness. Reversed, same meaning, but negative implications. This is, by the way, assuming you are using a Marseille deck that you've modified in some way or designed in a way to distinguish upright and reversed. Anyway, this is investment of too much in physical appearances. This is destructive rather than productive materialism. It can indicate a toxic relationship with money or consumerism, and a reminder from spirit that money doesn't buy you happiness. A person in the guise of a merchant weighs money on a pair of scales and distributes it to the needy and distressed. It is a testimony to his own success in life, as well as to his goodness of heart. When the Six of Pentacles from the RWS shows up, there will be a theme of gift giving and gratitude. The energies for ripening prosperity is all around you. This is also the card of public interest and social justice, a meaning embedded in this key that I've integrated into the SKT Six of Orbs. Now, take a moment to sit with how the imagery of the Six of Pentacles reversed makes you feel. Waite says the reversed Six of Pentacles is about the desire for all those things we just mentioned, but not having them in possession. It's the desire to receive gifts, the pining after material prosperity, wishing for better health, wealth, luck, or happiness. Waite uses the word cupidity, meaning avarice, greed, wanting access of the good life, not appreciating what you already have in hand. Be aware of jealousy you're directing toward others. In the Thoth Tarot, this is the Six of Discs, the Lord of Success. Crowley describes this card as the element of earth at its best. The deacon ruler assigned to this card is the moon in Taurus, and in Taurus, the moon is exalted. Likewise, the Lord of Success represents an exalted state of being. When this card shows up in your reading, change is soon coming, says Crowley, in the particular sense that a dream becomes materialized reality. However, success is temporary. You're not at the top of the mountain yet. You've got so much more work cut out ahead of you for even greater successes up ahead. How brief a halt upon the path of labor. That's the takeaway message here, albeit success is being predicted. Reversed, we maintain the same meaning of success, except now success is only a possibility, not yet a guarantee. In The Giver by Lois Laurie, a dystopian young adult novel published in 1993, there's a character called The Giver who transmits memories, and the protagonist in the novel is called The Receiver. Chalices, the Memory Keeper, and Orbs, The Giver, are the two passive suits, by the way. When I was in sixth grade, this was one of my favorite books. Here, I toyed with the idea of The Giver, The Receiver, and of memory. The suit of orbs is physical manifestation. So what are the physical byproducts of giving memory and of receiving memory? Now let's talk about card meanings. Upright, the Six of Orbs will reveal to you that the giver of gifts, a spirit of provision, is present. There will be harvest and nourishment. What fruits that flow from upper to lower will flow in return from lower to upper. Reversed, you'll see how instead of catching the orbs the way it appears in the giver upright, upside down, the orbs are falling away from the hand's grip. This is the energy of free fall. In Newtonian physics, free fall is when the only force acting upon an object is gravity. And with that, paradoxically, is the sensation of weightlessness, all while it is your own natural weight that is causing the movement of falling. The Six of Coins, Pentacles, Discs, Orbs in reverse is a cautionary note that you may want to take some countermeasures soon to stop the free fall. Assuming the placement of the veil that you see on screen, we are moving from the realm of balance, beauty, and harmony, Tiferet, informing how we interact with the tarot's sixes, to cross a threshold of consciousness into the realm of the sevens, Netzach. In the next video lecture in this Learn the Tarot Card by Card series, we are going to be covering the sevens, the realm of reasoning. This concludes our exploration and study of the tarot's sixes. Take one last look at the spread on screen to solidify your connection and now your clarified, deepened understanding of the six in the element of fire, six in the element of water, six in the element of air, and six in the element of earth. What is the common denominator you see across the four deck systems? In what ways do these deck systems differ from each other? Augment what we covered in this session with your own interpretations and perspectives on the sixes.